having a high volume of diaphragmatic hernias has enabled us to predict better for families where their baby, their unborn baby, will fall on the spectrum of severity.
All the information that we found on the internet made it seem like it was really hopeless.
The situation looked bleak to us.
It was extremely agonizing. I mean, I just kept on researching and finding out all of this information that was making me feel worse and worse about the situation.
Most moms who are diagnosed with a congenital diaphragmatic hernia come to us after their 18 to 20 week ultrasound. So we meet them very early on. The evaluation that they receive here includes usually a high resolution ultrasound, which can take 2 to 2.5 hours. The ultrasonographers are very careful to look at every single detail. The evaluation also includes a fetal MRI. We found that to be very helpful in determining liver position and in determining how much liver is herniated. They also all receive an echocardiogram. There is an association with congenital diaphragmatic hernia and congenital heart disease. And so it's very important to know if that those two are coexistent, because it changes how things are managed.
At that time, they were just diagnosing all of the specifics of how severe her condition was. So that was really comforting too, that they were really being thorough in finding out exactly how severe things were.
In the prenatal world, there still is no lung function test, so that we have spent a tremendous amount of time looking at other criteria to tell us how well this fetus is going to breathe once it's born.
There's a measurement that we use called the lung to head circumference ratio, or LHR, and we've been able to take that ratio of the cross-sectional area of the lung divided by the circumference of the head and break that down into different categories to be able to correlate that with long-term survivals and risk of other complications.
Clearly, babies that have a severe diaphragmatic hernia, have severe congenital heart disease, is a very poor prognosis group. Those babies that have a severe chromosomal disorder and diaphragmatic hernia, that's universally uniformly fatal. For those babies with an isolated diaphragmatic hernia, we usually talk in terms of fetal liver position and the LHR. For those babies with the liver down in the abdomen, with an LHR greater than 1.4, those babies do extremely well, can be quite sick though, of course, after birth, and the survival rate is probably 95% plus. Those babies with a very small LHR, say less than 1, with massive fetal liver herniation, those babies may be in the 50-50 survival rate group.
The crucial factor in whether or not a baby with diaphragmatic hernia survives is basically dependent on the size of the lungs, how well they function, and how well the blood flow is going through them.
We know well before the baby's born that the lungs aren't growing normally. And rather than going and fixing the hole in the diaphragm, what we really need to focus our research on is trying to make the lungs grow so that when the baby is born, there's sufficient lung size in order to exchange respiratory gases. Now, one of the ways you can actually stimulate or accelerate growth in the fetus is a surgical procedure called tracheal occlusion.
The rationale behind tracheal occlusion or tracheal obstruction is that the fetal lung before birth is full of fluid, and that fluid is under positive pressure. And that positive pressure is important to distend the developing fetal lung to make it grow. And there's strong experimental evidence that if you increase that pressure in the developing lungs with the fluid that's produced by occluding the airway before birth, pressure goes up, lung distends more, lung gets bigger, then that may have a beneficial effect.
Tracheal occlusion was first developed by members of our team, and where a clip was placed using open fetal surgery.
But some of the early cases that were done open were frustrating, and the outcomes were not as good as we had hoped.
When these babies were resuscitated at the time of the delivery, these were extremely sick, sick babies.
We know the lungs grow, they are bigger. But in our first group of patients, they didn't work better. So this was taken back to the lab to try to figure out the mechanisms behind that growth and the reasons that sometimes these lungs, that even though they were bigger, didn't function well.
So we essentially abandoned that approach for a number of years.
Since that time, a technique has been developed to do this in a minimally invasive manner.
They're doing endoscopic tracheal occlusion, so minimally invasive tracheal occlusion, and inserting these small balloons inside the trachea to block the lungs and stimulate their growth.
And then to deflate that balloon with a second fetal surgical procedure, either by fetoscopy or with percutaneous puncturing of the balloon, like with an amniocentesis needle, to reverse the obstruction, and then the baby would be born shortly thereafter.
The great attraction to this is that we've taken the risk to mom way down, and we've taken the risk for preterm labor way down.
So the baby can stay inside the mom for longer, the trachea can be occluded for longer, which also allows greater lung growth.
During that time period, there has appeared to be adequate lung growth to warrant further exploring that technique by our center.
The question is it better? And it's a question that we don't know yet. And so we really think it's important to study this very carefully, to choose the right patients.
Because we don't want to intervene if the baby doesn't need it. And then we need to test the biology that this will really work clinically to make a difference.
Just getting a survivor isn't the goal here. We need to be sure that we're having fully functional, good outcomes.
Hey, how are you? I'm Stephanie Kaspersky, I'm the genetic counselor.
The families meet with a genetic counselor who goes through their family histories. They meet with an obstetrician who looks back through all of their OB records. And then we have a team meeting where the family sits down with the obstetrician, the pediatric surgeon, our nurse coordinator, to go through all the studies that were performed that day and put them in the context of what it means for us and what options we may have to go forward.
They explained the test results to us, and they told us that Simone's case was not as severe as some of the other cases that they've seen because her liver was down, and that meant that her lungs weren't as compressed as they could be.
It's important that we look carefully and that we figure it out and that we give them accurate information. So that they can make decisions from there.
We found out that she actually had an 80% chance here. So that was the first time we really felt some hope that our baby was going to survive.